Access Book for Learning, we're going to find out with facts and figures. Let's explore together here whether you do really practice that as you claim you do. We're going to, first of all, to just try to be on the same page. When I talk about assessment for learning, what does that mean in terms of characteristics? All right? So how is assessment for learning, for example, different from, that's what you have, assessment of learning? All right? So what is it like? In what sense, in actual fact, what is it that I do differently in class? Okay, is that really true? Can't I do summative during? Yes, we can. Let's not talk about summative. Let's focus on formative. What is it that you actually do? Yes? Yes, please.
Now keep assessing your students as long as you go.
What do you mean by assess your students as long as you go? The word assess, can you just give me examples of what is it that you actually do in terms of actions?
You keep checking the information they have.
Okay. All right. How do you do that?
Evaluating.
Okay, you're going broader when you say evaluating. Okay, let's go down to assessing. In terms of actions.
Asking questions.
This is one thing. All right.
Judging.
Quizzes, okay, although I do that in summative as well.
Assignments.
Assignments, although I can do assignments for final summative work, sorry. So, how is it different?
Feedback.
Feedback. Alright. How is feedback? I mean, I can give feedback on assignments, can't I?
Immediate feedback.
Immediate. Honestly, I can't give immediate feedback on written assignments and sometimes oral. It takes me time as a teacher to process the student's work, reflect on it, and provide quality feedback, right? Mm-hmm. It's not immediate, never.
For oral, it's immediate or not?
Depends, all right, yeah. It's more instant than written. However, I can give delayed feedback on oral if I intend, for example, to take down notes or take recordings of the oral practice or presentations, and I can give delayed feedback. All right, we're gonna find out how many of us are really believers, and I don't want to keep you anymore. Let's look at some characteristics. The word feedback and comments is yes. All right. When I say formative or assessment for learning, first of all, the quality of being informed. It's not formal in the sense of final records of the student that go into their portfolios where they move from one level or get promoted from one level to the other. It's a different kind of assessment for the sake of learning for their own progress and development. So that's not in the sense of formality of the record, you know, that you put down forever and okay, based on which you make high stakes decisions. Somebody said something about evaluation. Evaluative decisions are high stakes. I cannot base high stakes decisions when I'm doing formative assessment, when I'm wearing that hat. Alright? So it has to be kept informal in that sense. Alright. Plus the idea of feedback and comments. You can put scores, although they are rather meaningless when it's formal, when it is assessment for the sake of learning. Grades are not the point, all right? Grades help more when you're giving evaluative judgments, but not for the sake of progress. I want to know, okay, my strengths, and what's the opposite of my strengths? Okay, areas for further development, areas for improvement. Very important that you realize that. If you ever think about that in terms of weaknesses, you're not thinking assessment for the sake of learning. It's counterproductive. The whole culture of assessment for learning is about progress and development and improvement. I'm at the point X. I want to go to point Y. How do I get there? It's not when I'm thinking negative. It's not what I'm thinking. I'm too weak to do it. I have to reinvest on what I already know, on what I'm already strong at, and work a little harder, become stronger in other areas. That's the whole notion. It's very much like bringing up a child. If you keep knocking them down on what they are weak at, they go the other way around. It becomes counterproductive. So the whole culture of assessment for learning is focus on areas, positive culture of development, all right? So think about it. Whenever you give feedback, wear this hat. Okay, you're bad at spelling, your grammar structures are horrible, you're no good at this, you're no good at that. It does reflect. It's your own culture, right? When you're too negative. Once you take that hat off and start wearing the hat of positivity, I have to really focus on what they're strong at first. You have to give them some reinforcement before you start giving that these points for development. Finally, somebody said something about ongoing, but it's tricky. The idea of it's ongoing, it means it goes back and forth. It's not like just I can do it in the middle or during. No, it's the idea is from the beginning to the end, if you like, right? It never ends, by you giving the student their assignment. It goes back and forth. The student looks at their assignments, look at the comments, and they react to your comments. So remember, your comments are meant for development and improvement. They have to show evidence on their improvement and give it back, whether to you or their peers. We're talking about that in a few. So are they going to deal with the process of improvement on their own, with their peers, or just you and the students? Because this is the culture of assessment for learning. You cannot overwhelm yourself as a teacher with everything and every single task. It has to be broken down, and you have to be involved learners in the process, right? So just so we're on the same page. Now, this is the culture, all right? How far are we there? Are we close? Are we far? Look at that person in charge. What are they thinking? What are they, how are they dealing with their candidates here? What are they telling them? The first thing, I'm the biggest criticism, all right? So, and what's the criticism here in their own point of view? Your draft is one-dimensional. Any idea why? The student is one-dimensional somehow. A stick figure. Yeah, if we reduce our students into one-dimensional figures, isn't that ironic? Because it actually is. You look at them all like one dimension. They are not like, rounded figures with different depths. No, it's just the face of it. You're good at spelling, you're bad at spelling. Your structures are horrible, your structures are good. And that's it, right? Certain expectations, and you sort of reflect on these expectations. It's the idea here of, putting people on just like one metric kind of measure and no more. No room for creativity. So to create that culture, instead of starting with my biggest criticism, how can you start? Can you suggest the phrasing? Can you find anything positive about that stick figure? Okay, so maybe you can start with that smile before you get to the point of one dimension. Alright, so, however, when I asked you about what is it all about assessment for learning, you gave me these broad answers. It is tricky, elusive. It's always easier to grab something assessment. It's very structured, okay? You give a quiz, you have scores, you put down the scores, and it's so straightforward. No trouble at all, right? Same with essays. You grade them, put down the grades, and that's the end of it, all right? Assessment for learning is rather too elusive and unstructured for our purposes, unless we have some sort of map, roadmap to help us out. And we need to know the direction around it, all right? I first started exploring the area. I mean, I'm into assessment and training and all. And I just preach about the different kinds of assessment. I've done that for years. When I sat down and I wanted to explore that in actual fact, I wanted to do a study with, you know, students at grade 7 in school and their teachers, I really was challenged with what is it that I can study? What are the areas, all right? What are the themes, all right? What are the things that teachers actually do with their students, all right? And that was a helpful model, really. All right, if you're thinking assessment and learning, you can think along these four areas. To start with, how to share learning outcomes or objectives, all right? So lesson objectives for starters, if you share them, that is number one step toward assessment for learning. Why is that? Any idea? What's the relationship between assessment and learning outcomes of a lesson that you teach? Any relationship? Yes?
I cannot assess my students on something that they've never learned.
Okay. As a matter of fact, the claim is there. That's right. The point is, we assess what we teach. By the end of the lesson, students should be able to do certain things. And your assessment should reflect these learning outcomes, so you assess whatever they have learned. You see? So it's the same plan as a matter of fact. So when they know what they are learning, huh? When you start assessing that, collecting information or data on that, it's easy because it's been explicitly shared. All right? Area number two is about questions. I think now both workshops dealt with the idea of asking questions, creating a dialogue, okay, two-way dialogue between the teachers and the students, asking questions and receiving answers. Different questioning techniques, different question types, how to start this dialogue. This actually creates the whole process of assessment for learning based on question-answer process. So the number of questions you have, the answers you collect reflect how far your students have learned. See? So knowing how to ask smart questions that will let you derive data, tell you, indicate whether your students have learned or not, that's a very important area. The third is about feedback, and I think the second workshop by Mona was all about feedback and techniques. There are, okay, feedback techniques and marking techniques, all right? They somehow overlap, all right? Sometimes I give grades together with feedback, sometimes grades only, sometimes just feedback in the sense of comments only, right? It depends where you are and the time. Should I give feedback when it's at the end of a course or at the end of the year? It's a waste, all right? So keep in mind when to do what. Finally, the fourth area is about self and peer. Self and peer assessment, all right? That's a big deal here when I'm dealing with assessment for learning, right? It's not summative. In the sense of, this is about informality, right? It's collecting data to tell me how far I've learned, I've made progress, and what is it that I should do to become better. So putting that on the shoulder of the teacher only is so much an overload. You cannot do that on your own. You've got to involve your learners. And you have to train them well. It's not that a hazard process. You cannot just tell them, okay, you assess yourself. It's not possible. You have to really train them, model your techniques for assessment. They have to show you that they are able to assess themselves and their peers. And they have to respect that. Because lots of the data I'm sharing today is going to show you that maybe they would not regard their peers' feedback that highly. They would just look down on their peers. Maybe I respect the teacher's feedback, but not my peers, and not all my peers. Maybe the good ones, not the bad ones. And often, things of the sort. You've got to be careful about that. So now that we've pinpointed the areas, let's look at that. Let's experiment together, all right? Like I did. This is going to be the first area, general perceptions. First of all, we're going to break up into groups, right? And for every group, we're going to have an assessment leader. Here we have Nib, all right? Anybody taking this area? All right. Anybody? They fled. I had Randa. Where is Randa? Randa, okay. I have Amira. I have Mustafa. Okay. Somebody can take that part of the room. Randa? Or Amira? Okay, thank you, Amira. Randa, you can take that one. And Mustafa.
Okay.
All right. So you're going to take, like, I think 8 people, maybe 10. Depends on the number of the section here. All right, now please. What you're going to do simply on a blank sheet of paper. We're going to try it out. One person only, the leader, is going to go around, including yourselves. You're going to include yourself as one of the... Professor, could you give include our young lady? Your name is? Your name is? Joanna. Hello, Joanna. All right, so just collect the answers. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4 items. Item 1, keep the numbers. Like item 1, 2, 3, and 7. So... this survey was given to both. Was given to students, grade 7 students in an Egyptian school, and teachers, their teachers, 3 different teachers. So, first of all, the students were given the question, do you think you're a good writer? Do you perceive yourself as a good writer? Yes or no? It's a yes-no questionnaire. And then you ask the teachers, all right, do you think, generally speaking, do you have this perception that your students are good writers or bad writers, all right? And so on. Like, do you do a lot of writing as a student? Do you do a lot of writing in your class, yes or no? And then you ask that teacher the same question. Third, do you do a lot of writing at home, all right? And finally, do you think you should do group writing tasks? Now, we're not dealing with students. You're dealing with yourself as teachers, all right? In English, how many of you do writing in your classes as teachers? Anybody who doesn't? Okay. All right, think of yourself as a teacher to be, okay, doing writing in class, all right? So, you answer the questions, yes or no, okay? Personally, do you think that your students in your classes are good writers, yes or no? It's strange, yes or no. I know sometimes it's 50-50. I'm not sure, but I need a general perception. It's a straight yes or no. Okay? Can you do that? I know it's difficult, but we need to think about it. This is your first step toward practicing what you teach. All right, who's the first artist? Thank you. So let me just give you the very first 5 minutes, and you can sit down in here, you don't have to step. So it's a closed questionnaire. And your survey up here. And here. Your survey. So, Mustafa, in test 1, how many of you think? Yes.
Question number 2.
How many of you
answered yes?
Let me see the question.
No? Yes, no, I know. Want
to explain to the lot of writing in class? Yes. Question number.
Yes.
Yes. How many of you? Yes.
Why the question?
Yes. You do a lot of writing in class.
Yes. We don't hear you.
About myself.
With your students,
as a teacher.
One. Three.
Yes.
Only three. What about no? How many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. What is missing?
Compare our results as a group, roughly speaking. Okay, so Mustafa, you have the first question, a majority of yes, that the students, you can perceive them as good writers. Just one note. Now, we're going to take care of the rest. The second question about whether or not we do a lot of writing in class, we have the five of them who assume that they actually have writing activities in class and a lot of it. At home, no, they are frank enough to tell us, okay, no, not at all. So not too many assignments at home. And by the way, assignments not in the sense of formal assignments. Writing assignment means I do writing for the sake of writing at home. I keep a diary as a learner. My teacher helps me reflect on writing at home. It's not just written assignments and essays or answering questions, you see. Lastly here, do you think you should do group writing class? The idea of yes as a majority, all right? That's roughly speaking. I'm sure the speed is going to be faster. Basically, I can see a trend here of more or less, like keeping me agree together here, yeah, more or less, we can compare, it's more or less the same. Sometimes we vary, number three, is it? We have a 50-50, or mostly.
Six say yes, and five say no.
More or less like a 50-50 number,
more or less.
All right. So, that's the idea. We're comparing the results across different groups. And again, remember, if you have your own participants, your own students, this is evidence of their own learning and their own beliefs about themselves. This helps you to compare. What is it that you all, I mean, personally perceive? Is it the same or different, right? And then we can compare. Just look at the data results here, and the survey results here. Basically, the yeses here, it's like collected all together. We don't want to look at the exact details, but there seems to be some variation here. Now, the whole lot here, now, there seems to be maybe. You wanted maybe, but I just wanted a yes, no. That gray area, people are not so sure, you see. But when you tell them to say yes or no, it seems more yeses than no. Okay? The middle area here of, again, yeah, there is some split here. And we want yeses here. No, yeah. So here, it's about, yeah, there is some evidence. All right? The idea here, I explored that further. I asked people to say why. Now, the survey here was done. Okay, slowly, with individuals asking them why they think what they think. So you can do that, but today we're doing it just, you know, quickly, just to give you a glimpse of what we mean, how to explore perceptions around assessment, generally. Now, it's interesting always to look at the qualitative data, the comments. Okay, student comments, yes please. Egypt. It's one of the national schools, but it's like experimental. It's one of those experimental schools.
Do you know its name?
Yeah, I do. I worked with it, with the school. All right. If you ever heard of the, you know, they call it the...
Harvard?
No. NES schools, if you ever come across them. NES schools. These are like, you know, yeah, STEM schools and, you know, those are governmental, but with certain, you know, they give teachers certain training and they follow. Anyways, these are student perceptions, how the students perceive the whole idea here of assessment and their own level. How do they see that? I'll just give you a moment here. Yeah, and that's the beauty of it. He knows and he misspells it. No problem. There is no harm, yes? He knows. The idea of being aware of your problem is great in its own right, right? It's not just I'm claiming otherwise. I know I have an issue with spelling. So what? right? As long as I know it, I can do something about it. And it's not bad to share the idea that I have a problem with spelling. So what? This is something good, that the teacher has nurtured the culture for students to be that much aware and sharing it without feeling bad. Okay, that there is nothing wrong with you having a problem with spelling. So the other one here, wrote good notes on my writing, the whole idea of appreciating good notes, good comments. Mind you, these are seventh graders, means little one. So we just have this, like, you know, I brought the four questions. The idea that students couldn't see themselves good writers for certain reasons. First, it's peripheral areas, what we call peripheral.